So, Arlen, tell me a little bit about your background. How did you become involved in comic books as an illustrator and a historian?
Well, I've been drawing superheroes since I was about 3 years old. I just always knew I was going to be an artist, and I collected comics and loved comics. I went through that period where you're about 17 or 18 where you think what you want to do for the rest of your life is go to work for DC or Marvel Comics. I went up to the offices when I was 8 or 9 years old, which was like going to, the Magic Kingdom or the Emerald City. You know, 575 Lexington Avenue had this magic ring. That was the DC offices. But I had a great commercial art teacher in high school who gave me a knowledge about commercial art and illustration, and that broadened my view of art and of comics. And then when I went to Rhode Island School of Design, because Walt Simonson, a great comic artist, graduated, who had a style that reminded me of Steranko's in the sense of there was lettering, graphic design involved. And once I got to art school and was turned on to graphic design, it gave me a wider picture of commercial art. And when I got out of school, I knew while I loved comics, I knew I wanted to go into more commercial art or graphic design, but never leave my comic book influences behind. And then after a few years dabbling around New York City, working in ad agencies as an art director, I did television graphics, I finally ended up, I knew Neil Adams ran a commercial art studio. And I was out of work, and that's when you have the courage to do something like show your sketchbook to Neil Adams. And when I did, he hired me the next day. And working for your childhood idol, I knew that after I got done working for him, I'd be on my own. Because after you work for your childhood idol, who can you work for? And I met my wife while working there, classic office romance, and we went off on our own. And I saw Neil turning away a lot of comic book art for advertising. I figured one guy can make a pretty good living just on the work he's turning down. And that's what my wife and I set out to do in 1986 when we left Continuity, and we've been the Dynamic Duo Studio ever since. But then, while that's illustration for advertising and editorial markets, there was always the historian in me that wanted to pay homage to the great comic book art and artists who I grew up with, who I never felt were given their just due. And as coffee table books started coming out about the history of comics, any history of comics I had ever seen was always text heavy with miniature reproductions. And I always thought that if I got the chance to do a coffee table book on comic book history, it would be more about the art with the text being secondary. So I started to do side projects on the side, lectures with slide projectors, and whenever I did these lectures, they were always aimed at a graphic design or art direction audience, or more of a lay audience than to comic book aficionados. Because that was my belief, that if we can't get visually literate people into comics, forget about the lay public. There's basically, try to get art people, people who are visually acute, to love and know comics, then it'll trickle down to the lay public, and those are the side projects I've always done, and culmination being my book, The Silver Age of Comic Book Art, trying to give those artists that I grew up with, including Neil Adams, their just due.
Good answer.
Hello.
No, that was great. That was great.
Yeah, just let me know if I'm running off
of
the
map. No.
Okay.
Believe me, more is better.
Good.
More is better. Now, Arlen, tell me about the lecture series you did, Superheroes in the 60s, Comics and Counterculture. How that came about, you know, what it included, that kind of thing.
Well, in 1979, my senior year at Rhode Island School of Design, you had to do a degree project, and it had to be something that was fairly massive and heavy. And all through my years studying graphic design, I always tried to fulfill the teacher's assignments, but somehow get comics in there as well. So I figured for my degree project, it's got to be something about comics. And what should it be? What should the theme be? It's got to be fairly weighty. And that's when I thought, I'll do an exhibit design, which is a field of graphic design, like you go into museums, the whole design, but it'll be about comic book art. And then, okay, what should my theme be? And I thought, well, it's got to be, you know, write what you know, write what you love. Well, I love the comics I grew up with. And I started to look at those comics and search for a theme, and I came up with this idea of, how did we get from the early 60s and the naive superhero comics of DC Comics to, 10 years later, you know, Green Lantern, Green Arrow with the Jesus Christ character hanging, you know, from the SST plane? How did we travel that? How did we go through the Marvel era? How did superheroes? And I thought, you know what? that related to what was happening in America at the time. We had the naive, you know, heroes of, you know, our childhood, of, you know, John Wayne cowboys and, you know, Sergeant Rock, you know, World War II heroes. How did we go from there to the way heroes were, to what our cinematic heroes were? You know, Dirty Harry and guys with guns and anti-heroes. So I started to put that together. That was 1979. Over the years through the 80s, I never did anything with it, but I always had it. And then the Art Directors Club wanted to stage luncheons with presentations. And I knew somebody there, I knew the president, and they invited me to give a lecture. And I thought, okay, what should I give a lecture about? And I still had all these ideas, but that I never did anything with. So I did a lecture called Superhero Antihero, Comic Book Art in the 1960s, back in 1992. And that was the first time that I actually put together a presentation using these images. So I always had that. And then when it came time over the 90s, trying to do a coffee table art book, I reworked ideas from that lecture into what became the Silver Age of comic book art. And basically, some of the very same layouts from my book, I still have the original layouts from 1979. So 25 years passed, and I was able, after 25 years, to capture and put down for posterity all those ideas I had from 25 years earlier.
God, that must have made you feel good. Yeah. I mean, it was such a long gestating project.
Well, number one, it makes you feel like I remember it like only yesterday, that I can't believe 25 years have passed in such a brief time. But it's also, you know, it feels great. It's somewhat of a vindication that, you know, in 1992, Print Magazine invited me to do this one piece. It was a monthly column called The Design Scene, basically a page of illustration that they would hand out to different artists to fulfill whatever the design scene meant. So I had an aged Superman in Times Square, you know, talking to an audience saying, comic books are books, comic books are art, comic books are graphic design, why won't you listen to me? Because I drew the audience just ignoring him. And that's basically my raison d'etre, that's what I'm about. And my book was my vindication. In the book, I print that image on my preface as if to say, it took me all this time, but I finally made my statement that comic books are books, they're graphic design, and they're art.
You know what has always astounded me? Comic books are one of the comic books and jazz music and a couple of things.
Right, musical comedy.
Yeah, purely American invention, right? The Europeans,
absolutely.
You know what I'm going to say.
Absolutely.
Why?
They appreciated Alfred Hitchcock and film noir as art forms before American critics. They appreciated jazz before American. It seemed like with the distance they have, literally and figuratively, they've been able to look at our art forms as art, whereas, you know, Alfred Hitchcock was just a slick commercial thriller movie maker before the Europeans said, hold on. And they, the whole idea of, what's the term? Auteurs came from the Europeans. So it just seems like America has always had this attitude, the critics, that we're not as good as European culture. Yet at the same time, Europeans have basically said, you stupid Americans, your art is right under your noses. Movies. Movies were considered claptrap for the masses until European critics said, no, movies are art. Go figure.
It's just so
same funny. Thing with comics.
Yeah, we were talking to Rich Buckle last night, and he does paintings now, surrealistic paintings, and he had a showing in Paris last year, and he was shocked. There were tons of young people in the studio where his paintings were. It came in there because they knew Rich Buckler, the comic book artist.
Yeah.
You know?
If it wasn't for the Beatles appreciating the American rock and roll that was trashed by the critics in this country, you know, Elvis goes into the army, rock and roll died. If it wasn't for the English Beatles resurrecting rock and roll and mixing it with their own influences, that we have rock and roll music today. Left up to Americans, it would have died out, or it would have just been pablum like in the early 60s before the Beatles made the scene.
Why can't we appreciate what we originate?
Because, like I said, we've been looking at old European culture. That's why American cities were built to look like European cities. You know, Washington, D.C. was based on, because we, the critics here, their idea of high culture was from the old country, from Europe. So nothing Americans could produce could match that.
Meanwhile, the rest of the world is like going, stupid Americans.
Yeah, it's right under your noses.
Gosh, I thought that was so funny.
Yeah.
Now, When did the Marvel Age of Comics begin?
The Marvel Age of Comics, as we know it today, began with the first issue of the Fantastic Four in 1961.
Now, keeping that in mind, mm-hmm. what, beyond just that it kicked things off, excuse me, what was the significance of FF number one?
Well, the significance of the Fantastic Four, you know, maybe not FF1 per se, but almost right from the beginning, and in fact, you could say right from the beginning, you have to look at FF in being in direct relation to the DC Comics superheroes that were prevalent at the time. They all had secret identities. They all had costumes. They all got along with each other. Every story ended where good beat evil. All of those things you could find in Fantastic Four 1, practically, no costumes. They argued with each other. The Thing was the first anti-hero. He was a monster as a hero. And those things alone, in stark contrast to the superhero universe, which was the DC Comics universe, just made it stand out. I mean, the fact that with issue 3, Stan Lee was already calling it the world's greatest comic magazine, I mean, they somehow knew what they were producing was miles ahead of what DC, not the fact that it was miles ahead, but so different. And what does it come down to? It comes down to Stan Lee's wife saying, why don't you write comic books for yourself rather than the way you've been writing comics all this time? It took a woman's point of view, how perfect, the great woman behind the man, to say to Stan Lee when he had nothing to shoot for. He was going to quit comics, I believe. And it was that inspiration. Plus, you have Martin Goodman, the publisher, saying, give me a Justice League of America. So if it wasn't for Stan Lee's wife, I don't think he would have written comics that way. But the whole idea was the DC superheroes weren't real. Oh, they lived in fictional cities. The Fantastic Four was New York. That alone was different. The husband and wife were married. They didn't have masks. All those things were just, it was like a black and white world compared to what DC was doing.
We'll get back to New York, but I wanted to ask you about what was the state of comics at this time? Because I believe really just right before FF number one, Marvel as it existed, which I think was
Atlas Comics.
It was Atlas. They were just putting out monster books, right?
Yeah, and sales were down. DC was doing well with its, you know, with its revamped superheroes, and that's basically where things were. But I mean, Marvel was hurting. I don't know to what degree the monster books, I mean, it was when Kirby arrived there and they started doing those monster books, but I think when Kirby arrived there, there's a quote from him that, you know, the movers were taking the furniture out and Stan Lee was left sitting on a stool. So I think the monster books that they did in the late 50s helped, I guess, bring them up to solvency, but it was the superhero books of DC that were catching their attention, and those, I believe, were selling well for their time.
It's an odd thing to think about, but a lot of people probably don't know this too, but, you know, DC was actually publishing Marvel books.
Distributing. Yeah.
Now, let's talk about that, because I know that there were rules, like they could only do 8 books a month.
8 books.
And the fact, from what I understand, the fact that the FF didn't have costumes, and the fact that there was the Mole Man monster on the front, and even the Fantastic Four logo type was kind of a monster kind of logo type.
Yeah.
They were trying to get it in under the radar.
Right. Right. But also, and this has been pointed out by some historians, is if you really think about it, the four characters were practically the same thing DC was doing, in the sense that some of them were revamps and revivals. The Human Torch was a 40s character. Mr. Fantastic, he can stretch. Not only was there Plastic Man, but DC had Jimmy Olsen every once in a while as Elastic Lad. Okay, Invisible Girl, well, you have the Invisible Man, basically. That wasn't so unique. But then you have the Thing. Now, you had, you know, examples of the Heap from the 1940s, who was sort of a swamp monster. The idea that Frankenstein was popular because Universal re-released the movie, even though he was a monster, he was the star. So really, it was nothing about the individual characters that was that unique, but it was the way they melded together and the way they interacted with each other that was unique.
Well, and it seemed like it started off that whole thing that became sort of like the Marvel, you know, monolith of the 1960s. But the FF seems so different because it was cosmic and at the same time very human.
Absolutely. And that was brought out in Kirby's artwork, which has been pointed out before, is that he could draw Thor sitting at a soda fountain drinking a soda and also have him in the, you know, intergalactic regions, and both were tied to reality in a weird way, his own made-up reality as well as naturality, or he could show the softness of a man kissing a woman with the same beautiful craft as he would show, you know, any one of his, you know, punches in the face that he was able to do so well. So that's why I think, you know, FF and the whole Marvel style and Kirby's work, you know, succeeded at the level it did.
Were there any were there any issues like This Man, This Monster, or anything like that from the, you know, that era of the FF that sticks out for you or anything?
You know, it's funny. People talk about This Man, This Monster. That's, by consensus, that's been considered the best Fantastic Four story. Usually ranking right along with that is the first Galactus Watcher trilogy. I happen to like the trilogy after that, which was when Dr. Doom takes over the Silver Surfer's powers. That one full page image of Dr. Doom standing over the Silver Surfer, to me, is one of the greatest full page images in the history of comics, to show victory and defeat in one single image as majestically as Kirby drew, to this day, remains beyond compare.
Wow, that's a giant, in a relatively short span of time in the 1960s, Stan Lee, Jack Kirby, and Steve Ditko really created most of the iconic characters in the Marvel Universe, and I guess it could be said they defined the modern superhero as we know it now. Could you discuss this? You know, like, sort of give me your take on that whole period.
Well, again, The Thing, Spider-Man, and the Hulk are three super anti-heroes. And it was that aspect that the superhero, I mean, if you start with one of them, you say Spider-Man with Ditko, the fact that Kirby drew some samples of Spider-Man for Stan Lee, and he had the foresight to reject them because even though these were never seen to this day by the public, they were the classic Kirby, you know, superhero. And Lee instinctively knew that Spider-Man as a teenager, number one, all DC heroes were above 30 years of age, as we knew by the generation gap later in the 60s. That was a big demarcation. So that was daring. The fact that it was superheroes with problems. Oh, getting back to the Ditko, the fact that he gave the job to Ditko, who drew drab everyman, and gave Spider-Man to Ditko was revelatory. And Spider-Man being young, being a teenager. Then you have the Hulk. Actually, The Thing predates Spider-Man. So you have a monster who's a hero. That was groundbreaking as well. For that era, again, you'd have to go back to the 40s in the heap. And then you have the Hulk, who's a sort of a Jekyll and Hyde character. So you have monsters as superheroes, teenagers as superheroes. You have people you don't expect to be heroes, blind men with Daredevil. So all the Marvel heroes were anti-heroes, anti-DC heroes. And that's what made them so successful.
And maybe the most glaring example of that at all, I guess, would maybe be the X-Men.
Yes, absolutely. Mutants as heroes as well.
Yeah. Because that was really, you know, sort of the, you know, the outcasts and counterculture,
right,
and things of that nature.
But the X-Men came after, like I said, with just those three archetypes. And you could even practically leave out the Hulk, because the Thing has everything the Hulk had. But I think the Thing and Spider-Man are the two greatest antiheroes. And you can even read in Stan Lee's synopsis to FF1, because you mentioned before, the very first issue, he talks about how, let's make the Thing the heavy, meaning the villain, because people won't expect that. Here's a guy with superpowers. Because with DC characters, the moment they have superpowers, I'll go and fight crime. Well, as he showed with The Thing, as well as with Spider-Man, the famous line about, save your breath, buddy, when the criminal runs past Spider-Man, I've got better things to do. If you have superpowers, either you wouldn't want to fight crime, or you'd want to make money with them. If that's not anti-hero heroics, I don't know what are.
Yeah, absolutely. Come on in. Of course, please.
Name one other father in Westport that's in this situation right now.
Oh, thank you so much.
Did you say salsa? Toss
up. And what's this little one doing over there?
She's coming with me. She took out her shoes.
Enjoy ballet. Marta, is this cool?
I hurt her feet.
Ow.
Meanwhile, her drawing for Cheetah Tales, which is like the school annual, just got selected to be the cover. So the art talent has been handed down.
Well, I would think so with both your mom and your dad.
I've been getting in for 3 years.
Yeah, I would hope so.
Okay, come on, girls.
Now that's some salsa.
All right, salsa. Bye.
Okay.
Bye.
Bye.
See you tonight. See you when you come back. Have a good ballet.
All right. Are you guys gonna be here? When
I don't know.
I don't know.
We'll see.
Let's take my
microphone. Okay. Yeah, I put the heat on. It was cold in here.
Okay.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye.
Okay.
Have a good ballet class. I must tell you, your children are much, much better behaved than Chris Claremont's.
Thank you. I'll pass that on.
Those boys.
Really? How old?
They were 7 or so.
Like 7 and 8.
They were really tired.
Well, boys have boy energy.
Well,
that's why.
They had been up like the night before because they had just gotten back from a plane trip and they were really tired.
Yeah.
A lot of energy. Gosh. Just focusing on Jack Kirby for a second. Why is Jack Kirby so important that all these years later, even after he's passed, it's been 11 years, we're still talking about him? He is one of the few comic book creators who has, you know, a regular magazine devoted to him. Mm-hmm. Why was Mr. Kirby so important?
Jack Kirby was one of the most unique artists in the history of art, not just in comic books. And everything Kirby touched was unique. And his imagination spanned so many characters, so many concepts, that they are the types of characters and concepts that keep speaking to new generations. They're not locked into a certain time, although they are of their time. Like things that are universal, Kirby's work, he was a storyteller as well as just an artist. So Kirby's stories, his characters, his visual concepts were both of their time and timeless as well. And you can only find that in very few creators in any field whose work stands the test of time, yet was of its time as well.
Good answer. Kirby himself was a tremendous designer, wasn't he?
But in a sense, an unconscious designer. Kirby's work, from a graphic design standpoint, everything from the squiggles, his technology style, the way he designed shadows, his equipment, the costumes, there's a total graphic design sensibility that was consistent through all his work. Yet, I believe if asked, Kirby probably wouldn't consider himself a, quote, designer. But that's what I mean about his unique style. Everything he touched visually had the Kirby look. And you could identify Kirby's work from a square centimeter on that page. You would know that was Jack Kirby. You can't say that about most other artists.
A lot of artists we've talked to at one point or another in their career either were forced to ape Kirby or did it voluntarily. You know, John Romita taking over the FF and Steve Rude has sort of made a career out of it, and Rich Buckler and a lot of these people, Herb Trimpe. They've all said the same thing that...
But it also made, if it's okay if I interrupt,
yeah, please.
It also made their work better. Artists like John Romita, Gene Colan, John Buscema came into their own, not when they took over Kirby's titles, but when they first came to Marvel and Jack Kirby's work was so successful and Stan Lee gave them the dictum, try to understand what Kirby's doing, look at how he does things. Those three artists' work took a quantum leap in development because they were, quote, forced by Stan Lee not to imitate Kirby, but to understand the points of view Kirby was bringing to his work, the excitement, the dimension, the explosiveness of it. So all those three artists' work developed their most mature, best styles during that era because of Kirby's positive influence on their work. Some of the other artists maybe couldn't quite get it, but in Romita, Colan, and Buscema, their work only blossomed because of Kirby's work, and their best work is because of that.
It was the why and not the how.
Right.
Yeah. Because Romita was telling us that he could, when he was doing it, he said duplicating Kirby mechanically, it was very difficult, but the hardest thing was trying to think like Jack. He said his imagination was so beyond anyone else's.
Gil Kane's work, I think I document this in my book, but Gil Kane's work also took that quantum leap. It became much more dynamic because he was seeing what Kirby was doing. Again, the DC Comics artists were stayed two-dimensional. They were told to be very, not stiff, but that was the DC look. Once Kirby came on the scene, according to Gil Kane, everything changed. And he incorporated Kirby's dynamics into his own work, and that made Kane's work take this quantum developmental jump.
Kirby just must have influenced. He
did.
I mean, the 1960s really belonged to Marvel Comics. They really did. Why did Marvel surpass DC in terms of sales?
In terms of sales?
Yeah. Well, in terms of sales, in your opinion, in terms of quality of the books, everything.
Well, what really happened was because of their sophistication, because they were not, in a sense, dumbed down to a childhood audience, Marvel started to attract an older crowd, particularly a college-age crowd. And that is what started to get Marvel Comics a leg up on DC. And as time passed, as the 60s wore on, I think Marvel overtook DC in sales not until the early 70s. I believe. I may be wrong on that. But the bottom line is that DC was never able to get the college audience that Marvel got. And not that, I don't know how many numbers they were, but the point is Marvel Comics captured the imaginations and captured the times and the spirit, the zeitgeist of what was happening in the 60s. DC never really had a clue, and by the time they did, it was too late. Marvel had overtaken them in sales.
So DC was still sort of in the 50s.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It really wasn't until Dead Man appeared in 1967 did DC have a, quote, realistic character. And in fact, I believe Deadman, according to legend, is the only comic that the Marvel professionals were reading at the time of DC's output.
Really? That's interesting. Huh. Now I want to get back to New York for a second because for the most part, well, actually not for the most part, for the entire part, the Marvel Universe took place in New York. Did that have a lot to do with the book's success? I mean, because like New York was a real place instead of opposed to Gotham and Metropolis.
Yeah. In addition to all the character traits of the FF, arguing with each other, the fact that they were a family, the fact that they didn't always get along, the fact that they had rent problems, things like that, just the simple fact that Stan Lee decided to set the scene in New York just made that identification with his readership that much more real. Spider-Man lived in Forest Hills. It was things like that, little touches, that meant so much because for years, the comic book audience had been fed a steady diet of fictional cities. Gotham City, Metropolis, Central City.
Yeah. I mean, the FF, it seemed like they were always on the Lower East Side.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Well, I think the Baxter Building was, you know, right in Midtown, you know, Manhattan. I don't believe there was the Yancey Street, you know?
Now, within this period that we're talking about, mainly in the 60s, Jack Kirby is really going strong with Marvel, and there's a young man that's coming on named Neil Adams.
Mm-hmm.
And what, because you really would be able to contribute to this, what was Neil Adams' contribution to this period that we're talking about in comic book history?
Neil Adams, right from the start, when his work appeared in 67, brought a photographic realism to comic book art that had really never been seen before. And that alone is what made people's eyes bulge out, because when you take an unbelievable fantasy world that comic book superheroes were and make it look real, you get an entire new breakthrough happening in comics. You believe that these characters, the musculature, the perspective, the way the characters expressed emotion, all of these things had never been seen before as realistically until Neil Adams' work. The reason why movies like Star Wars are successful, special effects are successful, is that the more you make the unreal real, the more identification you'll have with an audience. And that started in comics, really, with Neil Adams' work.
It's really incredible that, you know, it's sort of like the Star Trek, Star Wars thing, but I love Kirby's work, and I also love Neil's work, and I probably shouldn't.
No, they're on opposite ends of the spectrum. The unique style of Jack Kirby is the essence of exaggerated anatomy, is the essence of stylization. On the other end of the spectrum is photographic realism. And what's very interesting is that neither artist could really do the other's characters, because when Neil Adams drew Thor, he looked like a long-haired hippie with a helmet on. It was too realistic. When he drew Black Bolt, in other words, Kirby's majestic characters were brought down to earth by Neil Adams, and they weren't as good. Kirby, on the other hand, never drew a convincing Batman. The few times you see him draw Batman, couldn't pull it off. Kirby couldn't draw Spider-Man. So the thing is, the more realistic characters Neil Adams drew well, the more majestic, unreal characters Kirby did well. One is real, one is stylized, but they're both the epitome of those styles, just on opposite ends of the spectrum. Adams is usually never considered to be on an equal plane with Kirby because Adams, quote, didn't create his own characters. What Adams did was he recreated characters. He revamped characters and made them real again. In the eyes of most comic book historians, that's not usually put on the same plane as Kirby's original characters. But again, you could look at Kirby's characters. What is new under the sun? Everything that's so-called original is made up by combining two things, usually that have never been combined before. So you could actually piece apart Kirby's characters and see the elements that they came from, like the Fantastic Four being modeled on the DC Challengers of the Unknown and things like that.
Now, were you a fan of Neil's work on the Avengers and the X-Men? What did you think of that?
Once I was a fan of Neil Adams' work from the get-go with Dead Man in 1967, I became a Neil Adams fan. So whatever he drew, you went after. Even though I wasn't a Marvel fan at the time, I loved everything Neil did.
Yeah, I really, really liked his take on the X-Men.
Oh, yeah. His X-Men, to this day, is still being, in a sense, influencing and... I mean, Neil has said this himself, that everybody who takes on X-Men does their Kazar story, does their, you know, where they go to the Lost Jungle, the Sentinels. Everybody forgets that X-Men was a dying comic. It was only reprints by the time Neil and Roy Thomas took it over in 1969. The X-Men are so prevalent today, but they were really on the B-list. Even when they started, the X-Men were in the shadow of the Fantastic Four, and by the mid to late 60s, they stopped doing original stories because they weren't profitable, and they were doing reprints. If it wasn't for Neil Adams and Roy Thomas, what we know of the X-Men today would have never have happened, because in 1975, when they were revived as the new X-Men, both Claremont, the writer, and Dave Cockrum, the artist, were so heavily influenced by the Adams-Thomas collaboration that they wanted just to do their own version of it. And that's how we get the popularity of the X-Men today.
Can you discuss a little bit, we've kind of mainly been talking about Jack and Neil, but some of the other artists in that time period as well, especially at Marvel, that were doing, you know, amazing things. I'm thinking about Steranko.
Well, Jim Steranko kind of hit with an impact right before Neil Adams hit. Jim Steranko was the first artist at Marvel Comics to be allowed to write his own stuff, the first writer-artist, in 1967 when he was doing S.H.I.E.L.D. He followed in the footsteps of Jack Kirby, but right from the beginning, I think within a handful of issues, he was writing and drawing as well. And then he introduced pop art motifs. He brought back what everybody had forgotten was the ideas of Will Eisner. The graphic ideas, the storytelling ideas, the whole cinematic panel development, things like that Bernie Krigstein had done for EC Comics. So Steranko started bringing all these influences, photo collage. He saw what Kirby was doing with photo collage. Steranko one-upped him. And all those influences, Steranko's art, he combined the best elements of Jack Kirby, the explosiveness, with the storytelling elements of Will Eisner and put them together and created the Steranko style, which was literally the equivalent of what Jimi Hendrix was doing in rock and roll at the time, Steranko was doing with comics. Then all of a sudden Neil Adams hits on the heels of Steranko and brings in photorealism to some of the same things Steranko was doing in terms of cinematic panel layout. And, you know, those two were operating on, you know, twin engines at the time in 1968, 69, 70. And those were the best things coming out of comics at the time.
Amazing. It was funny, I got to see, we're going to see Barry Smith on Monday, and I got to see some early tryout pages he did for Marvel. And
totally Kirby.
Well, Kirby and Steranko, really. It was some cat pages. Do you know
right.
what I mean?
Yes, he did Daredevil for two issues.
It's like Barry's early tryout pages, like Captain America, he was longer, not as compact as what Jack did, which is more Steranko. But it had that vitality. And that's a funny thing because, like, Steranko was like a melding of Kirby, but he did something unique with it, too.
It was postmodern Kirby. It was taking Kirby and saying, what is it about Kirby's work that is so phenomenal? And again, Steranko came from an art direction background, commercial art, just like Neil Adams did. So he, by definition, had a different way of looking at comic book art, whereas Barry Smith totally came out of comics, and so I think his first published work, these two Daredevil issues, was like, what, is Jack Kirby ghosting Daredevil? What's going on here? But that's the difference.
But then he broke free when he did Conan. And
yeah.
Barry's one of my favorites. The Red Nail story.
Yeah, absolutely. Some of the most beautiful comic art ever.
Ungodly.
Yeah.
And, you know, I'm going to ask him about it, but I just imagine that kind of detail work.
Yeah.
And
that's why it didn't last long, you know. The problem with comics, which is why Neil Adams left, which is why Kirby was able to stay in comics, was because he was as prolific as he was profound and turning out so many pages and not having to slave. I mean, Steranko, according to Joe Sinnott, his inker, slaved over every page and was late on deadlines. Neil Adams was late on deadlines now and then because, you know, Rome wasn't built in a day. Beauty takes time to create. But Kirby was a workhorse. And according to Mark Evanier, his historian, didn't pencil things out like other artists, just drew from start to finish and made the image appear on the page. Like they used to say Michelangelo used to look at a block of stone, see the figure within, and then cut away from it. That's how Kirby looked at a blank page. He kind of saw the image and just made it come alive.
Well, and Kirby never went back either. John Romita was telling us that Kirby and Buscema were always giving him hell because he would slave away on pages and erase and go over, and Jack said, don't be stupid, don't do that. I mean, I've seen original pages that Jack did. The eyes would be uneven and things like that. He didn't care.
Yeah.
He was getting through it. You know, he figured Joe Sinnott
right. Joe Sinnott will fix it up. Well, whereas Vince Coletta, of course, fixed it up all right. Let's not get started on Vince
Coletta. We won't even start on this.
Yeah, I mean, this isn't necessarily for the record.
But
the revelation with John Morrow printing the pencil pages of Thor. You know, if I ever do another presentation to show what those pages looked like before Coletta got a hold of them, I mean, we'll never know what Thor could have been like had Joe Sinnott been inking Thor, you know, in terms of what the work is still brilliant, even with Vince Coletta, you know, the horrible things he did to it. But, man, seeing those pencil pages.
Well, for me, it's a funny thing because I love Joe Sinnott, I really do, but still my favorite Kirby inker is Mike Royer. Because Royer really just traced.
I've got a bone to pick with you.
I do. Royer really just traced. And to me, that was the purest.
You know what? People love that. Talk about graphic design. What I don't like about Royer's work is not so much his inking, but I don't like his lettering. And you look at, you want to get into the fine details of comic book art. You look at the lettering of Artie Rosen and Simic and the letterers Marvel had. You look at the lettering to any FF with the lettering of Michael Royer, bad type in graphic design pulls down the best artwork. You could have a child draw an advertising illustration. As long as a professional typesetter is doing the type, a graphic designer, it can look like a real ad. But you can't have a professional illustration with bad type. Bad type will pull down good art. And what I don't like about Royer's pages is I think his lettering is terrible. And that, to me, pulls down the work. In addition, I like the slight fixing up that Sinnott did. I like the slick line that Sinnott brought. All of Kirby's tropes, the elements that we think of when we think of Jack Kirby, the shock lines, all things like that, the dotted galaxies, those were first brought to life by Sinnott's inking. Royer came after Sinnott, and a lot of people like Royer. I find that Royer's stuff just lacks that slight slickness that Sinnott brought to his work.
Well, it's interesting that you brought up the point, especially about the lettering, because I've been thinking so much about Alex Toth lately. I'm a huge Toth fan, and you know, he always did his own lettering, and you know, incredible.
Yeah.
And he always talked about how the balloons and the lettering are just as much a part of the art as anything. And he said, you know, you can fuck up a beautiful illustration with bad judgment.
I'll give you the best example. Winsor McCay's Little Nemo. I cannot read, literally, a page of Little Nemo. The artwork is beyond compare, gorgeous, beautiful. But the type, he looks like he drew the balloons first and then squeezed in the type. It's poorly designed. And to me, it pulls down, as great as Little Nemo is, as total artwork, the horrible word balloons and the bad type pulls down Little Nemo to the point where it's practically illegible. And all I can do with Little Nemo pages is look at them. I can't really read them.
Yeah, I guess it's true.
Compare the lettering in Marvel to Royer's lettering, and you'll see it's literally like night and day.
Okay, I will. I'll look at it. One of the things I know that in your lecture series you were doing, you know, about comics and what was going on in the 60s, can you talk about some areas besides even music where, you know, Marvel artists in particular, or just artists, influence other things like maybe album covers or posters or things like that?
Well, I think the biggest influence Marvel Comics had were on Ken Kesey, who wrote One Flew Over a Cuckoo's Nest, and basically with his Merry Pranksters introduced LSD to an American audience when it was still legal. In 1964, when he was going across the country dousing American cities with LSD on the Magic Bus, according to Tom Wolfe, who wrote the Electric Kool-Aid Acid Test documenting those years, not only was the bus festooned with Marvel Comics characters, but Ken Kesey was reading Doctor Strange at the time. And if Doctor Strange wasn't Eastern mysticism and psychedelia 4 or 5 years ahead of the San Francisco School of Rock posters, I don't know what was.
But I get it, it's kind of amazing because you know, Jack really loved those collages that he did.
Yeah.
You know, he loved them. Nobody else did. I know Joe Sinnott hated them. But I remember seeing them in the reprints, and I was like, whoa, it's crazy. What did you think about the collage?
I liked them because, again, I liked comic book art. So anything that was fresh and new and different, you know, why not? You know, bring in photography, bring in other elements. That's why I think Neil Adams had the impact he did, Jim Steranko had the impact they did. Anybody that brought in outside influences into comics always made a splash. Every once in a while, DC would do a cover colored with watercolors. Those always jumped out of the stands. I always wondered, why don't they do more of these? You know, to this day, you look at those covers, they're iconic, they're incredible. And that's the thing. It's like the more diverse influences, the better. Comics are words and pictures. There's no limit on how good the words can be. There's no limit on how good the pictures can be. So why not bring in anything and everything into comics?
Now, Arnold, what happened to comic books after the Silver Age? I mean, we know where we are now with comic books, but I mean, as a direct result of those years in the 60s and early 70s, did certain things happen? You know, in terms of like the underground comic movement and things of that nature.
Well, the underground comic movement kind of died out in the early 70s because there was so much legislation and anti-pornography and the head shops were closing down. That's what happened underground. Overground, DC Comics became no longer the industry leader. Marvel became the leader, but Marvel, it was a case of meet the new boss, same as the old boss. Marvel style, once Kirby and Ditko left, became sort of solidified and never really went anywhere after that because it became the Marvel style, and individuality started getting eked out to what became a kind of a bland overall look, which was ersatz Kirby. And every time an original voice like a Jim Starlin would come in or a Barry Smith, they were too unique. They burnt out after a while and left the field. So Conan, under John Buscema, became marvelized. Spider-Man, under John Romita, became marvelized. What was unique about Spider-Man, unique about Conan, were the things Ditko and Barry Smith brought to them visually. So the overall Marvel look became this sort of watered-down Kirby look, yet it sold better than ever. The John Romita Spider-Man became even more popular. Romita Spider-Man became the logo of Marvel Comics. But that design is still Ditko's design. And then comic books, you know, sales started dropping, I think, as then we move into the 80s. And, you know, you have video games and the computer becoming popular. And I don't think comics have ever reached the point that they did in the 60s during, you know, the heyday of the Marvel age.
It astounds me when I think about, you know, I did a little research in the numbers that they were posting back then compared to, you know,
now. Oh, what's happening now?
Oh, I mean, it's... What's happening now? I mean, do you have any opinion about... Because I don't know what's happening now.
Well...
Where books are selling, like, 30,000 okay. copies is, like, good.
Okay, right. I think what happened is that in the 60s, as a direct result of comics being more mature because of the Marvel Comics explosion, you had people growing up with comics. Comic book audience used to last for a while, and then you left your comics behind, like you left your toys behind. The Marvel era, they were comics more than an older audience, so the audience grew older with them, to the point where that older audience started to work for the comic book companies themselves, where the idea was, let's make comics at an adult or more mature level. The problem is, they lost the knowledge and the wherewithal of how to make comics for kids anymore. So a new audience that would come in, everybody that's older began reading with comics. The past 10, 15 years, or 20 years, you no longer have that new audience coming into comics because A, you can't find them, they've been ghettoized into comic book stores, and B, there aren't comics for kids anymore to bring a whole new audience. C, the first things they're being exposed to now are video games and the computer. So that new audience that was always taken for granted, that would always be coming into comics, is no longer coming into comics. Marvel and DC are being run by people who don't know how to produce comics for kids. So you don't have that new audience. You've got this dwindling audience. And even though these movies are so successful, people aren't leaving the movies and going in to buy comics. They don't know how to cross-promote. As far as I'm concerned, you should go into a movie theater and there should be a rack of comic books. When you go into a Spider-Man movie, there should be a rack of Spider-Man comics. The comic book company should put that into their contract with the movie companies that you have to display and promote the comic books that these comic books are based on. They don't do that.
No, it's
so how ironic that the influence of comics right now on the American pop culture is greater than ever. And yet, the actual sales of comic books are lower than ever. That is a bittersweet dichotomy or a paradox.
And it's such a sad thing to me because, you know, like, I know that Marvel sells these CD-ROMs mm-hmm. that have, like, all 500 issues of Spider-Man.
Right.
I have no desire.
There's nothing like holding a comic book in your hand and reading it. And what's sad is that people will come out of Fantastic Four movie and not necessarily pick up the great Jack Kirby work upon which this movie owes, you know, its legend to.
Well, I'm hoping that maybe they won't do it when they come out of the theater, but when they get this DVD and
absolutely
all this stuff, maybe it'll lead them to some further
absolutely
you know reading. I'm always curious to hear different people's takes about the comic book, you know, because there was an AMC documentary a couple of years ago that Stranko and a lot of people.
Yes, Heroes Unmasked, right.
Heroes Unmasked.
Which, by the way,
yeah.
They never asked me for my input, but I'd like to think that their kind of chronology of the superhero would have. I'd like to think, I'm watching it and I'm thinking, man, I think whoever wrote this thing, Stranko was a consultant, but I think they lifted from my sort of timeline or whatever,
yeah.
The way I kind of drew things and all that.
They probably did.
Yeah.
I remember seeing it and I said, that wasn't bad.
Right.
You know?
Well, because they had Steranko as a consultant. But
exactly.
I was always going to be Steranko's apprentice. In 79, when I was at RISD, I went down to interview with him at Reading because he was one of my heroes. and he wanted me to be an assistant, but I was still in school, and you know, I didn't take him up on it. But just like I got to work for Neil, I almost got to work for Steranko.
I'm trying to land him for this too, Steranko.
Well,
I don't know him.
I have a backstory about how he didn't give me an interview for my book. I had to take over from Secondhand Horses because he wanted input. He wanted creative control over his pages.
Maybe I won't go see him.
Well, I'm saying good luck.
Yeah.
But
well, I'm not giving him creative control.
Well, no, but that's my point. You know, good luck, or he wanted money. Yeah. Steranko was one of the only artists that was alive that I interviewed who wanted money. And yet he never gave me, he wanted me to make some money offer. I had no money.
Well, see, that it's funny that you
It'd be like me standing here and saying, how much are you going to pay me for this interview?
But that's what, like, some people have done that. Like, Dick Ayers told me he would do it.
Yeah, if you pay him.
I call him. Well, no, he said he'd do it, and then I called him back to confirm. He said, you know what? You're trying to screw me. And I said, no, Mr. Ayers, I'm not. You don't understand. I'm not 20th Century Fox. We're a small production company that's been hired. The budget that we were given, I'm using it to travel around and talk to people. But that costs money.
But listen, Steranko's always been mercenary. But the bottom line is that here I was doing this book, doing what his agent, David Spurlock, calls the best thing that's ever been done on Steranko. You know, he griped about the number of pages I was giving him, that it was less pages than, you know, so-and-so. I mean, every little thing, and I still have all the correspondence that one day, if I showed it to you, it's like anybody, that know, it's hilarious.
Good, then you've dissuaded me now.
And then, well, all I'm saying is give it a try, because he, you know, he's a great Kirby authority, and all I'm saying is good luck, because, you know, he wants all his I's dotted and his T's crossed, and he may put you through hell, he'll give you a great interview. All I'm saying is,
I don't need to know that.
I'm just saying.
I need to go through all that because I'm going to have.
But this is what you should tell David Spurlock, his agent. You can say, listen, I'm doing this thing. You know, I don't have the time, the money, and the wherewithal to go through Steranko's bullshit. You'll come up with a nicer word. Yeah. If he wants to be a part of this, let me know. But if not, I'm not going to lose any time or sleep over boo-hoo, Steranko won't participate. Because that's what I basically said to Jim. When I finally stood up to him and said, Jim, thank you for your time. I'm going to do it. Then he writes me back and he says, Arlen, are you sure you don't want to rethink your position? I have something about my Silver Age work that I've never revealed to anybody. If you call me tonight in my studio and, you know, basically agree to my things, I'll give it to you. And I was like, sorry, Jim, I won't be calling your studio tonight. You know?
That's wrong.
And a year later, I finally asked David Spurlock, what was the big secret he was going to tell me? You might as well tell me now. It turns out it was nothing.
Yeah.
But he thought I was going to be a fanboy, that he was going to dangle this cherry in front of me, and I didn't balk at it.
Well, Dick Ayers said, you know, well, you know, you're trying to screw me. Well, I said, I'm sorry you feel that way.
Yeah,
I'm
so did you...
hung up.
So...
No, he's not.
It's his loss.
It's you know. Yeah. It's I look at it like this.
Yeah.
There are a lot of wonderful people who are contributing, and you know. It's going to be wonderful.
Absolutely.
He'll be the jackass that's not in the Jack Kirby tribute that millions of people are going to see because he was greedy.
And since they're all dying off.
You know? But that's what I mean. It's like, you know, Mike Ward.
This is for posterity. Yeah.
The world, he said, "I'll do whatever you want."
That's right.
You know.
That's right.
Joe,
I mean, listen. There are things to make money on, and there are things you do as labors of love. And if you can't draw that distinction, that leads to problems.
That's what this is. We're not going to make any money on this. I'll be lucky if we break
it. But even if you did, I mean, the whole point is that this is not the kind of thing that you use as a money-making thing. This is not a freelance assignment. I mean, how ironic is that?
Well,
because there's still, by the way, there's still a fight to this day over why the Fourth World books were canceled.
Still?
Infantino always says it was pure sales figures.
But someone dug into the files and found out that that was horseshit.
Well, Adams, when you talk to Neil, and this will be like off the record, he's got this whole theory because his comics were canceled also by Infantino according to sales. But Adams claimed that it all had to do with this affidavit returns and books coming off the truck and taken, stolen from distributors' warehouses and blah, 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 blah. He's got this whole theory about how those comics actually sold well.
Yeah.
But actual sales were not reported back by the distributor. And that's what gave them and Infantino the right to say these books have to be canceled because they're not selling.
Yeah, we were just talking about World War II and the number of books were sold. But remember that weird thing at the very end of the 80s and early 90s where they did like the relaunch of X-Men with Jim Lee and Todd and Spider-Man and all that? And they sold like 6 or 8.
Well, that's because of speculation.
Yeah, but let's talk a little bit about the speculation, because that, to be honest, that was when I got out of comic books for a while because it just broke my heart.
Yeah.
I mean, let's talk a little bit about that period in the speculation, the goddamn 5-10 foil covers and all that stuff, and what that did to comic books, in your opinion.
Well, what it did was it forced a lot of retailers out of business, less comic book stores. It forced just gross imitation all over the place. It forced you to buy, if you were a collector, you know, multiple copies, or they had variant covers. It was a lot of excess. And there was really no value in there. The only good thing that came out of that era was that those top creators, the Todd McFarlanes, they stood up to the major companies who thought that it was the characters that sold the books, that anybody could draw Spider-Man and it would sell. And guys like McFarlane and Jim Lee stood up to them and said, no, 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 no. It's the creators who do these characters and do them well that make the books sell. And when they stood up and form their own company, because previously, whenever superhero comic artists left the company to do their own thing, like Ditko and Wally Wood and guys like that, the books never sold well and always failed. Image Comics was really the first company made up of creators who left the big companies on a dare and succeeded. And that coincided with the whole speculation era. And, you know, Jim Lee survives as, you know, one of the best comic artists, and Todd McFarlane ended up with a multi-million dollar corporation based on Spawn. So some good came out of that, but overall it damaged the industry. But the industry seems to be coming out of that. I mean, it lasted for any number of years, but it seems like it's healthier now in the early, you know, 21st century than it's been for a while.
I just wish that when I went into my local comic book shop, that I saw some kids in there, because I don't. You know, they're all my age or older.
Yeah, well, that's the problem. You know, on any given Friday night, you know what movies are playing. You know what books are available. You know what TV shows are on. You know what's happening in culture because it's on television, it's in your newspaper, it's on radio. Commercials, advertising, and promoting these genres. Except you have no idea that comic books exist. There are no advertisers, there's no promotion. And if there was, you have no idea where to get them. Comics used to be in supermarkets, they used to be in candy stores, things like that, 7-Elevens. You can't find them. Mothers would rather go into Walden Books and B. Dalton and Barnes & Noble to children's book sections and get their kids to read than go into comic book stores, which they don't even know exist. And if they did, they look like places where the flood hit. And there, you know, there's very few comic book stores that look like as good as real bookstores. So all of these things are like dominoes hitting one another. The fact that there's no promotion or advertising. What good is a great product if nobody knows about it? Comic books are a perfect example of that. There's great product there that nobody knows about it. And yet it's changing incrementally. In the New York Times, just the other day, the second page of the art section has single items about what's happening in various pop culture and art genres. And there was an item about DC's recent release about the Infinite Crisis. And I thought, wow, that's the first time I've ever seen an item about comic books be on the same plane, the same level, as all these other items about dance and theater and movies and music. So it's things like that that have to start happening more in order for comics to get out of the ghetto that they're in.
Yeah.
And they are in a ghetto.
Well, they are. You know, when I the first comic book that I ever bought, it was, you know, it was out of a spinner rack. It was at a Walgreens. You know?
I learned how to read. I was reading comics before I even learned how to read. I remember sounding out. I remember there was a Superman story where he loses his powers and has to create a new identity, which he calls Omnipotence Man. I remember sitting there going, I didn't know what his omnipotence was. And the fact that a writer would write a Superman comic, which was ostensibly aimed at eight-year-olds, and would use a word like omnipotence, shows that even when people thought comics were being aimed at kids, they really weren't. The vocabulary was an adult vocabulary. Words like hoax, elongated, invulnerable. These were words that no other 7 or 8 year old was using. Alias. I mean, those were comic book words. To this day, my vocabulary still comes out of the comic books I read when I was a kid. And they're not given their just due for that very reason.
You and me both. I told Chris Claremont that, you know, he was greatly responsible for me being able to use $25 words.
There you go.
He put his hand on my shoulder and said, fuck, you make me feel old. You know, but I was talking about, you know, the Iron Fist that he was doing in the 70s. And it's so funny. But it makes me sad sometimes because I think that I'm 33. Mm-hmm. I am probably the last generation that was really, you know, like, obsessed with comic books.
Yes.
I probably am.
Well, the computer and video games have hijacked the young audience, leapfrogged over comics, because now the movies and the computer and video games are doing all the things that used to be the province, I don't know if I'm using the right word, of comic books themselves. So special effects like stretching and things like that, they can now do in movies. So comic books have to look at themselves and say, what can we now provide the audience that they can't find in movies and in computer video games and things like that? There's no sense imitating what movies and computers can do better than comics. We've got to give people the page-turning, storytelling, visual, verbal medium is still what's unique about comics. They're not as passive as movies and television. You can take your own time reading them. You can flip back, you can go forward. I mean, yes, you can do that at home with movies. But the whole idea of comics, that it's a verbal, visual, storytelling medium, is what's unique about them. So stop trying to imitate movies and television and video games and the computer. Comic book creators have to start doing things that make them unique, that can only be done in this form.
Are there some stories that can really only best be told in comic books?
There's a certain intimacy with comics. Autobiographical comics, particularly, autobiography, is done very well in comics for that very reason, is that you can get into a person's mind, because it's not just the way they think. It's not just prose when you're reading prose books or autobiography, but you're getting, in a sense, to see what they see. And so much of knowledge is gained by what we see, I think, more than what we read. So it's that combination that makes getting another person's life and another person's story. This is why underground comics became successful and created a whole genre, because people like Robert Crumb were giving themselves to the comic book page. They weren't just telling stories about other characters. So the idea of somebody expressing their point of view and the way they see the world can be done in comics. Probably maybe better than in any other medium.
Why do you think that the Fantastic Four has sustained for these, you know, 44 years? Why do you think? I mean, you know, we're talking about it now. There's a movie coming out. There are 3 books that are monthly published about the FF. Why do you think the FF has sustained?
It comes down to the characters and the way they interact and the fact that they're a family. That makes them unique. In comics, previously, the bands of heroes were bands of heroes. They were never a family. I mean, yes, I guess you have the Captain Marvel family, but they were separate members that had their own adventures. Once in a while, they get together. It just wasn't the same. It was the Fantastic Four, and it was the fact that they had real relationships with each other. Reed and Sue were married. Johnny was a brother. Ben Grimm was a friend. Those core relationships. I think you look at any successful narrative genre, a family, whether it's Swiss Family Robinson or whether it's the 3 main characters on Star Trek, anytime you have a family of characters, that seems to stand the test of time.
Good answer. Good answer.
Whoa.
Good answer.
I read it off the teleprompter.
That's a good answer. is there anything that we didn't touch on? We covered a lot of things.
Yeah, I'm trying to think if we touched everything.
Yeah. One thing important.
Yeah. I just want to talk about, if I'll just say this off the top of my head.
Please.
Sometime around 1964, Kirby's work seemed to just take this developmental leap where he began introducing the photo collages, and the work just became getting better and better and more explosive and more dynamic. And then in 65, the end of 65, you have Joe Sinnott inking him. At the same time, Kirby is introducing characters like the Inhumans and the Silver Surfer and Black Panther. And I'd like to think that at that point, Lee and Kirby's work was the equivalent of what Lennon and McCartney were doing in rock and roll. And the way Lennon McCartney's work took that leap with Sgt. Pepper and beyond, at the same time, Kirby and Lee's work took that leap and became psychedelic and more explosive, and they were the Lennon McCartney of comics. At the same time that Lennon McCartney were doing for rock and roll, Lee and Kirby were doing for comics, and they were the first Fab Four. And one little footnote is that Martin Goodman, at the last second, changed Stan Lee's title of the very first issue, what would have been the Fabulous Four. He changed it to Fantastic Four. Had Lee kept his original title, they would have beaten the Beatles by about 3 years with the phrase the Fab Four.
That's awesome. That's awesome.
I found that in some obscure, I think it was in, there's a hardcover book, The Art of Jack Kirby. I think it's in there. And, you know, in my book, when I do the four, I wanted to get that in there. They make a perfect match, you know, the four black and white faces. But I think I've said about, you know.
It was, you were just making me think of Paul McCartney. I remember reading that story that Jack.
He was a big fan. Yeah.
They went to see Paul McCartney in Wings.
Right.
Jack had done that sketch for them.
Right.
You know.
And didn't Wings do a song something in
Magneto.
The Magneto and the Titanium Man or whatever?
Yeah,
it was?
That's what's amazing. Yeah. You know, they Paul, I guess Paul, Linda, all of them, and all the band members, they were always reading Marvel Comics on the bus.
Well, you see, that's the thing, is that all the great rock and rollers of the 60s were also artists. Mick Jagger went to art school. Eric Clapton went to art school. John Lennon, I believe, went to art school. So I've got to believe that those guys were reading comics during that time. And it's coming out now, years later, you know, that McCartney was, you know, a Marvel Comics fan and things like that. But, you know, so many of the great rock and rollers of the 60s were also comic fans, and chances are they were reading Marvel Comics more than they were reading DC Comics.
I remember seeing concert footage of Paul McCartney and Wings, 72 or 73, and they were actually performing Live and Let Die.
Mm-hmm.
But there was a giant Kirby Magneto.
Really?
Huge, like
really?
On stage behind them. And
really?
He was there for when they did Magneto and the Titanic.
Wow.
That song.
Wow.
But, you know, like Jack and the family went to see them. And
yeah.
I just thought that was amazing. And Jack did a drawing for them of Magneto holding his hands out, and Linda and Paul were in one hand and the band was in the other.
Yeah.
I just thought that was even.
Yeah.
I really like that analogy of, you know, the musical analogies. Because I kind of imagine that time in the 60s.
Okay.
You know.
Rock and roll comics, I've always had my pet theory about this, had the same development. The fact that The Flash comes out in 1956, the same year that Elvis Presley basically emerges. So, you know, rock and roll and comics had the same development. So you move from the 50s into the 60s. You have the Fantastic Four and you have the Fab Four happening. In the 70s, when alternative comics like Dave Sim-Cerebus and Love and Rockets came out, you have punk music redefining what rock and roll could be. So rock and roll comics have always had, they've both been outlaw art forms. They've had the same sort of skewed development, you know, almost at the same time, you know, things are happening. And to a certain degree, traditional rock and roll is sort of, has been dying out for, you know, the last 10 years. And you have, you know, comics dying out, so maybe, unfortunately, they're following the same path there.
Now you're freaking me out.
Yeah.
Because I was just starting to think about, you know, like the big hair bands and all that stuff in the 80s, and comics were very similar to that in the 80s.
Yeah.
And then, you know, grunge and everything took over, which is like the Image guys.
But, you know, look at the Rangers. Today's pop. Listen, I'm a fan of Bruce Springsteen, but I mean, you know, once Bruce goes, you know, he's the last standard bearer of traditional great rock and roll. There's very little of it. You know, you have U2, you have maybe the Rolling Stones, and it's a short list.
Yeah.
You know?
Real quickly, could you tell us what the posters are behind you?
Yes, these are facsimile reproductions of posters that came out in 1970 for a fan club organization called Marvel Mania. And Marvel Mania was not produced out of the Marvel offices, was sort of subcontracted in California, but they were able to get Jack Kirby to draw Fantastic Four, Doctor Doom, Thor, and the Silver Surfer posters, which, as you can see, are some of the most, you know, iconic images of these characters that, as only Kirby could do them.
The Doctor Doom in particular is gorgeous.
Yeah.
Just amazing.
But this is what I mean. All of these ideas, the idea to do metal, the squiggles, I mean, everything that you see there, the hands, the basic posture, is...